1950 and to today, today 83% of New Hampshire is forested. So we've kind of come a long way back from the all the cycle that began with the use of agriculture. And with the abundance now of habitat, especially in the forest, we have a return for some of the forest species. And a particularly interesting example is in 1975, the turkey was absent from New Hampshire, but the Fish and Game Department brought in 25 birds under the funding of that Pittman-Robertson Act, wildlife restoration. Today, it's estimated there's over 30,000 turkeys. So a very big success in restoration. Through some other processes, there were some absences of eagles and falcons and osprey within the 1960s. And starting in the 70s and 80s, I get some restoration activities going with the federal-state partnership for eagles, falcons, and the like. In this era up to today, we had a big return of white-tailed deer. They're so abundant that in some areas, their impact on the understory of the forest is twofold. They will chow down on the young emerging trees to the point where they just can't grow. And then also that some of the shrub habitat in the understory was necessary for forest birds. If the understory is gone because of deer, that starts a cascade for other species. So deer's one of the examples where wildlife is managed, the numbers are managed through hunting. Moose made a comeback in most of the state. We also have pretty broad return of big bobcats. There's probably the last part of the state to see bobcats was the seacoast. In 2008, there's a population that's in the seacoast area. And the beaver that we're trickling back in, those are now in every water course in the state, and they're back doing their changes to the habitat, setting up ponds and meadows again. So the picture for mammals is pretty good in the latter part of the 20th century, especially those that are forest-based. Yes?
Can you talk, I understand the moose population is declining now, though.
Yeah, there are some issues with moose, particularly in recent years. There's been this tick, which is responsible for a lot of problems with the moose, and there's some other diseases that have come. Yeah, there's a brain wasting disease that's come in again. With it's one of the carriers is white-tailed deer. So again, there are some issues here with moose populations. One other just perspective on wildlife is provided by birds. Birds are often an indicator of environmental health. There's the old adage about having a canary in the coal mine to provide warning about noxious gases. And in more of a contemporary application, birds were an indicator species for problems in the 1960s. We started to see, especially raptors, who are at the very apex of their food chain, no longer reproducing, and very, very steep declines. Some detective work brought that back to the use of DDT, which has been very prevalent since World War II. So again, raptors and birds in general can often be good indicators of environmental health. What also happened with that DDT and the loss of raptors, there was a very influential book by Rachel Carson, mentioning a book in the library here, Silent Spring, that had a very big impact on the public's attitude towards wildlife. So in 1966 through 2010, we've accumulated a great deal of information about bird populations, often through the hobbyist birders who are collecting that information, as well as serious professionals. In 2010, Dr. Pamela Hunt from the New Hampshire Audubon went through a lot of the data that was available and tried to come up with a report called the State of New Hampshire Birds. It was providing population trend information across 186 breeding species within the state. This is kind of a busy slide, but I just want to point out a few things. It's showing the 186 species spread across this set of habitats. Each little column here represents a different habitat type. And we won't get into all the details, but I just want to pull a few key things out. The red, blue, and yellow are there signifying different trends in the number of species for that particular habitat, whether they're in decline, as shown by the red, whether they're stable or increasing, as shown by the blue, or if the data really is inconclusive, as shown by the yellow. And one of the things you might notice, if you look at all the habitats kind of pushed together, there's about an equal number of species in red as in blue and as in yellow. So about a third of the bird population across the state is in decline, about a third is stable or increasing, and about a third is kind of unknown. The height of each column is a representation of the number of species in that habitat. The first two columns cover our two main forest types within the state, the spruce fir forest in the north, the hardwood mixed forest, mostly in the south part of the state. And you can see here, they're not only the biggest, but if you look at the blue portion of it, those have the highest number of species that are stable or increasing. So that indicates generally a pretty healthy forest species situation. On the extreme right is a habitat type called developed areas. So that's really kind of the second biggest category. You can see a lot of the species that have adapted to human habitats have also had a high proportion of stable or increasing numbers. You can think of robins or some of the things that you see around your neighborhood as cases there. Looking again at the forest, even though, again, the numbers are looking pretty good on the stable or increasing side, there's still a significant proportion of the forest species that are struggling a little bit. And again, birds might be providing us some hints about even the forest habitat. Taking a little bit closer look at the forest of today, there's most of the trees are about 7,500 years old. In 1938, there was a major hurricane that came through New England and portions of New Hampshire, significant parts of the forest were wiped out, or all the trees were overturned. Going back to the early part of the 20th century, we had that big burst of logging. So the forests have all kind of a general middle age profile here, 75 to 100 years old. And we've also reduced some of the natural disturbances and how that cycles into the age of forest. There's no longer fire allowed to just run rampant, although that hasn't been a huge factor. But there's also places where we put in dams and stop the periodic floods that have replenished some of the wetland forests. So today's forests are not as diverse as they were 400 years ago. And they're really probably one of the bigger factors is that it's more fragmented forest. We have some of our own habitat, the suburban communities springing up amidst the forest, and there's no longer just the contiguous forest areas. On the right here is a real extreme case of this forest area surrounded by development. This also gives an opportunity to look at, well, we've had disturbances to the forest in the past. How does our current set of disturbances rank there? And really, the biggest change with the type of disturbance that our current development scheme creates is that concrete and asphalt are much more permanent than the use of forests for agriculture or forestry or hunting. So with the forest being fragmented, we have to be a little more vigilant about setting aside land that's particularly valuable for wildlife purposes. There's a somewhat regional effort I'd like to just use as an example here about conservation land. A group of different nonprofits are working in a program called the Quammen to Cardigan Partnership, and they're trying to set up a contiguous area from northern Massachusetts up to the edge of the White Mountains, where critical forests are set aside and all of the, as many of the connections between them as possible are being targeted. Connections are important for wildlife to be able to not get isolated in different gene pools. And also, there's some thought that there's a benefit for, as climate change affects the wildlife picture, that more ability to migrate between different zones could be important. Just going, checking back in with the birds again. This graph shows a couple of areas where there's the highest proportion of red. So those are the habitats where there's most of the species are in decline. And so let's take a look at what those are. It's shrublands and grasslands. A grassland is pretty self-explanatory. This is kind of the classic pasture. There's a number of indicator species here, the raptors again. The northern harrier is a raptor that makes use of grassland for hunting purposes, as does the American kestrel. The northern harrier has been declared as state endangered. Some of the pollinators and butterflies are also have undergone steep decline, and a couple of reptile and amphibian, northern leopard frog and smooth green snake are also species of special concern. And basically what it comes down to is the birds are telling us up a story here, but for the wildlife professional, it was pretty well understood that the grasslands and shrublands have really been declining as the forests have come back. Shrublands are another stage of the forest succession. The American woodcock and the eastern towhee, a couple of species that have declined substantially. They're shrubland birds. A state endangered mammal, the New England cottontail, is another species that makes use of shrublands. So there has been a concerted effort among some of the government agencies, including Fish and Game, the USDA has a program for wildlife habitat restoration. There has been work done by a number of different organizations to try to restore some of the shrub and grassland areas within the state, mostly by cutting back the mature forests and some of the more mature shrubs. The federal government, in the form of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, very recently, like 3 weeks ago, announced a proposal for the an area across all of New England, but focusing, in our case, on a couple of areas within New Hampshire. They're going to target land acquisition, again, if accepted, within a couple of zones, one of which is south of Manchester, and another one to the east, and closer to the seacoast. There are other habitats which are significant in with respect to wildlife. The Fish and Game Service has done a plan called the Wildlife Action Plan. It's identifying key species and habitats that are the most threatened. The action plan is available for use by state agencies, communities, land trusts, and individual landowners. In New Hampshire, 80% of the land is actually owned by private landowners. There's 84,000 to be reached out to talk about wildlife. So there's some tools that have been created by Fish and Game and the UNH Cooperative Extension. I've left some pamphlets out on the table and back. Some of you picked them up. Feel free to do that. Let me know if there's more needed. Also, if you're a homeowner, you can request a county forester to come out and do some looks at your property and come up with your own paper plan. Just to look at some local things here about land conservation. In 2014, the Hooksett Conservation Commission identified that 24% of the land is under conservation. So congratulations to the town of Hooksett. They have benefited from some assistance with the Bear Paw Greenways program. I also had some brochures on the back there for that. And just to kind of wrap things up, there was a lot here for over 400 years, but some things to consider. Nature is dynamic. There are cycles of disturbances and then followed by succession. Diversity of habitat allows for diversity of wildlife species. Human impacts have changed biodiversity and species abundance, sometimes on the downside by man-made disturbances, but also on the upside from management of wildlife and habitat. So that's the presentation I had for you, and I'd like to thank Matt and the Hooksett Library for this opportunity, and open it up for questions. Yes?
Just a couple years ago, coming back from the Adirondacks, my wife and I were coming through Vermont, and we saw a very large cat. And when I get home, I called New Hampshire Fish and Game, and they told me to call Vermont Fish and Game, which I did.
Yeah.
And they confirmed that it was a cougar.
Wow.
If they had had other calls in the same area about that same animal.
Yeah.
And it was running so fast and right in front of my car, and we both saw it and we recognized it immediately as a cougar. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, very fortunate.
Yeah. I'm always interested when I hear about this 84% of the land in the state being forested. And
yes.
I go through these urban areas without seeing trees. How is that calculated? Do you have any idea?
I don't. I confess I'm a volunteer, and some of this data is coming from the Cooperative Extension. So.
Can I just add to that? I think I read somewhere that they use aerial surveys, and New Hampshire is unique in that we have, in spite of the fact that there are shopping centers and stuff, but our urban areas, even the cities, have a lot of trees in the cities. And if you look out in other parts of the country, there's nothing.
Yeah.
And if you look in, even I live in Manchester, and I've got huge trees in my neighborhood. So
those would be counted as
a percent. I think they do aerial surveys. I think I read that somewhere.
You can find it's done by satellite.
Okay, yeah. Some of them, yeah. Do you happen to know if they still do prescribe burns in the pine barrens? You talked about.
Well, I think up in the coroner. butterfly restoration area around the Concord area. There is an active program.
Ossipee.
Yeah, that could be. Ossipee is another area of pine barrens. Yes?
Do you think that the proposal phase was sure enough that most of the species that were here before the bulk of the agriculture happened are still here nowadays, or have we lost a big chunk of the biodiversity?
Not sure I got all the question.
It was mostly forested and there was a lot of agriculture and now it's going back to forest land.
Yeah.
Do you think that most of the species that were here before are still present as far as tree species and...
Well, as we saw, there's been a number of what they call extirpations of species are gone from the state. The wolf is one, the cougar, despite possibly being sighted. And
what about the flora?
And
so the trees.
Yeah, I think there's kind of a mixed picture there. There's a lot of the we had all these things like the recently emerald ash borer, the pine, white pine blister, the various things taking out individual trees. I know that that would affect the overall ecology. I don't know about maybe the understory plants.
Does the Extension Service put out a pictorial of various paw prints of the various animals here in the state?
I do know that I have seen those. I don't have any with me. I would try. Okay, so that kind of gets to a couple of things. There's a New Hampshire Fish and Game website. I'll go with that. You can download that off of the Fish and Game.
Mm-hmm.
There's
one of the speakers that we had here, they had samples of the different prints trying to usually sell those guides up where they sell animal guides, bird guides. They usually have the guides.
Yes. You mentioned bear paw.
Yes.
And there are a number of conservation entities in the state.
Mm-hmm.
That's one, the Society for Protection of Nature Parks is another. And online, if anybody's interested, they have on their website a listing of all of the places in New Hampshire that you can hike and that you can go in the woods and check out all the habitats and whatnot. It's pretty cool.
Yes.
I just want to say that we as homeowners can help a little bit too by, like for instance, the monarch butterfly is really in decline.
Yes.
If we could plant milkweed in our gardens, that would help a great deal for the monarch and other butterflies besides.
Yeah, that was part of the thing about grassland and shrubland is helping pollinators. Yeah. There's I know New Hampshire Audubon is also engaged in some replacement of grassland and
St. Paul School.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
They're working with St. Paul School.
Up in Concord. Yeah. Yes.
What was the gentleman's question? What was he looking for?
It's a kind of a guide that would identify different paw prints of the various, say, bear or...
Nature Fish and Game. You have them all lay out posters which show all the game, and we have
track, little cards that show you what all the tracks of the animals are, which are great for people who hike and get out in the woods. Just go to fishing game department, they've got a whole section there of literature.
Okay, thanks.
And I guess a word from our sponsors. You can sign up for a newsletter called Taking Action for Wildlife. That's out of the Fish and Game. And there's also opportunities to get some additional data from the UNH Cooperative Extension Service. They offer some workshops. And so a couple of websites here to do some follow-up with.
Thank you very much, Bill.
I guess that... I'd also point out that...